last time we talked about these addressing modes. So any question on these? Okay. So I want to mention a couple of things before moving on. Yeah, and we also talked about how big the displacement should be, how big the immediate value should be, and so on and so forth, right? So if you look at, so there are a couple of things. The first thing is that, so these are essentially, as we said, these are register operations. This has nothing to do with the memory, right? Whereas the rest would go and access memory in some way or the other, all right? And the special case was this one, which actually accesses memory twice. Okay, all right. Now, of course, as we'll go along, we'll find that these two are usually the most frequent addressing modes that you observe in programs. Okay. So, the natural question that arises is, under what circumstances the compiler generates such instructions? Okay. Because the compiler has the ability to always generate this instruction, register indirect. You can always put the address in a register and can generate this instruction to access that particular memory. Okay. So the question is, why should the compiler need this instruction? So that's a very valid question. So that's one question we'll try to answer. The second question is, which I want to address first, is if you look at these addressing modes, the way you address the memory, particularly if you take these two, you find that we have a very compact way of representing the address in the instruction. So essentially what we're doing is we're putting the address in a register and we don't have to put the address in the instruction anymore. As long as I put the register index 1 and register index 4, my instruction is complete. And of course, along with the opcode of add. Okay. So previously, if I backtrack a little bit, we were talking about this classification here, right? That we have this classification based on number of memory operands, number of register operands, and so on and so forth. And we said that if we have memory operands, your instruction size might increase because you have to put a big address in instruction, right? But of course, that's not exactly correct. Now you can easily see that because we have other compact ways of representing addresses. You can put the address in a register and can just put the register index in the instruction, and that's enough, right? So, but of course, if you are using absolute addresses, your instructions, then of course you'll have to put the full address. But actually nobody does that. That's a very infrequent way of accessing memory. And the obvious reason now should be clear that it would increase your instruction size. You'd always put the address in a register and then generate the corresponding instruction, like one of these. Okay, right? So only here we talked about putting the absolute address, but you seldom find such instructions. So the second question was that why should compiler generate this instruction, displacement-based addressing? Okay, because the compiler can always generate this one. It can put the address in a register and can generate this instruction. So this one you will find very often when accessing the stack. So usually you have a stack pointer, which is a register. And if you want to access something in the stack, you generate a negative displacement here from the stack pointer. Right? Okay. Negative or positive, depending on which way your memory grows. Okay, right? Similarly, if you have some pieces of global data, usually global data are stored in a specific region of memory. And the base of that memory is pointed by another register called the global pointer. Okay. So if you want to access some data in the global memory, you'd essentially generate a displacement with respect to the global pointer. So these are the cases where you'll find that you'll find displacement-based instructions getting generated by the compiler. All right. And of course, as I said, this is a special case of that with the displacement of 0. For example, if you want to access the top of the stack, it will generate this instruction with R1 being the stack pointer. Okay. All right.
So this is called register type of ISA.
Here, for example, we are allowing you to do ALU operations directly on a memory operand. So this would be like a memory register ISA, in fact. Okay.
It is simulating memory register with register, or it's a memory register?
No, it is a memory register, actually. One operand is a memory address. It's only that we have a compact representation of the memory address.
Okay.
So you're using register to store the memory address. That's it. There is no other difference. Okay. Whereas if you just to remind others, if you have forgotten, if you only have load store instructions allowing memory operands, then that would be essentially a register architecture, where your ALU operations will operate only on registers. Okay.
And as you mentioned about the, we put the memory address on in a register.
Yeah.
So, I mean, following that, the displacement addressing mode should also be done like index addressing mode, because you can store the displacement in a register and then use that.
Sorry, say again, what's the exact question?
So displacement, you put the displacement in the instruction itself.
Right. Yes.
Which may take lots of.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So you're saying why not use this one?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a very good point, actually. So I was exactly about to mention that. So why would I need this one? Right. If I have this one, I should be able to exactly synthesize this. The point is that your displacement would be limited to a certain size in the instruction, because see, displacement will actually appear as a constant in your instruction. Okay. So there will be limited number of bits given to you for encoding displacements. Suppose you want a very large displacement. How do you do that? Well, then you have to resort to this one. You have to use the index addressing mode in that case. You put the displacement in R1, put the base in R2, and generate this instruction. Okay. Right? Does that answer the question? Okay. Anything else on addressing modes? Any other questions? So in these last three cases, this auto increment, auto decrement, and scale. So first of all, let me remind you what this is. So essentially here, we are taking the value at location pointed to by R3 and adding it to R4 and putting the result in R4 and also incrementing R3, right? That's what we said. Similarly, in auto decrement, you would decrement R3, and the scaled case, we would be essentially adding R2, R3 and 100 and generating a memory location. In certain processors, you'll find that there is one more extra parameter, and that is usually programmed into the processor before you invoke an auto increment instruction, and that is by how much you should increment. Here we are assuming by default you should increment by 1, need not be. So usually the processors would usually have an instruction before auto increment which would actually program that special register which would be implicit here. Okay, so you would increment by that amount, and the reason is that you might have an application where your array elements are not exactly 1 byte, right? So here we said that you could initialize R3 to the array base, and you just want to add all the elements of R3 cumulatively, okay, right? So in that case, you just do this instruction in a loop, and automatically the R3 will get incremented. So now if your array elements are not a byte, you'd want to increment it by a larger amount, right? And that's exactly where this becomes handy, that by how much I should increment that particular flexibility, okay, all right? Okay, so digital signal processors, you'd see two special addressing modes very frequently. This is usually called the modulo or circular addressing mode. Here, auto increment, auto decrement with automatic reset when end of buffer reached. So this is very useful for streaming data. You're streaming through a data, and when you reach the end, it is automatically reset to that, so that you're now prepared to stream again next time. Okay, all right. There is another addressing mode found in digital signal processors called the bit reverse addressing mode, specially designed for fast Fourier transform. So I'll not go into the details of this. If you know about FFT, you would be able to understand why that is needed. If you don't know about FFT, I would suggest that you go home and read about it. You'll understand why this is actually needed, bit reverse addressing mode. Okay, all right. Now the important point is that the compilers may never be able to generate these addressing modes because identifying such a situation is very hard. Like, as I told you last time, first of all, the compiler will have a hard time figuring out that an FFT is going on. You're given a, you know, large piece of code, and it's very, very, you know, difficult for the compiler to figure out that, oh, this is an FFT actually, right? So I should be generating bit reverse addressing mode. That's almost impossible. So essentially what happens is that you'd have hand assembled libraries who would actually hard code these addressing modes in the instructions. You won't rely on the compiler. So as we go along, DSP applications get larger and compilers become more and more important because gradually we are, of course, improving your DSP compilers as well. So in summary, addressing modes should be simple. Displacement and immediate are popular. So again, I'd like to remind you that whenever you talk about the immediate addressing mode, it doesn't refer to accessing memory. It is referring to operating on a constant. Okay, all right. So it's not actually accessing memory. Remember that. And you can always emulate register indirect with displacement, because register indirect is just a special case of displacement, displacement zero. Your addressing modes must match the ability of the compiler to use them. Very important in desktop server market, because here, you know, hand-coded assembly libraries are just out of question, given the wide variety of programs we run. Displacement should be 12 to 16 bits. So this has pretty much become the de facto today, based on your statistics collected from applications. We discussed this last time also, that the displacements are usually small. This turns out to be enough in most cases. Immediate should be 8 to 16 bits. Again, that's again based on your statistics collected from applications. In reality, these use the same space in the ISA encoding. So the immediate and the displacement actually use the same bits in the instruction encoding. So we'll look at concrete examples when we talk about the MIPS. Yes?
Is there any specific reason in every addressing mode they have at least one register?
At least one register operand, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes, the reason is that when you are designing the ALU, for example, right? Usually the ALU generate a result in an register, right? So that's the reason why you'd want to have at least one register in the instruction. So you could hide that as well. See, I mean, it's all about what you expose to the outside world. So underneath, what is really happening is that whatever memory operands you have, ultimately, the memory is accessed and brought into a temporary register inside the CPU. Otherwise, you won't be able to invoke the adder, out of question. Because the adder takes inputs from two registers and puts the result in another register. You could hide all these three temporary registers from the programmer. The programmer would actually see accessing two memory locations, getting the result back in another memory location. That's possible. So the next question is, how big should my operands be in my instructions? Okay. So this is usually specified in the instruction opcode. So here again, we are talking about the memory instructions, okay, right? Because when you have register instructions, of course, your register size fixes the operand size automatically. Okay, all right. So usually, these are specified in the instruction opcode, like we talked about last time, bytes, half words, words, or double words. So in this class, we'll follow the convention that a double word is 8 bytes, 64 bits. Word is 32 bits and half word is 16 bits, and a byte is of course 8 bits. All right. Characters are usually bytes, but 16-bit Java Unicode is also popular. Integers. So again, here what I'm trying to do is, when you have a high-level language program, that will have data types, right? Characters, integers, reals, floats, depending on in what language you are programming. Now, the compiler will have to compile that data type and will have to map it to some operand type in the machine, actually, in the instructions. Okay. So there has to be a mapping, one-to-one mapping between your high-level language data type and your instruction data type. Okay. So for example, when you're operating on a character, your instruction should be actually a byte instruction. It should generate some instruction that manipulates bytes. Okay. So integers can get mapped to half word, word, double word, depending on what data types the programming language actually offers. Okay, because it varies a lot. For example, if you are doing programming in C, you'd have short ints, you'll have ints, you'll have long ints. There are various other flavors. Okay, right. So it all depends on how it's exactly interpreted. So essentially, compiler would know the meaning of these things. Like when you say short int, compiler would know what it means actually, okay. And it would automatically generate the corresponding data size in your instructions. Floating point numbers are usually expressed in IEEE 754 format. So these are standard actually. So 32 bits or one word for single precision, 64 bits or double word for double precision, and there is another 80-bit extended precision. Right. So these are again standards. So whenever the compiler sees that you have a double variable, it would probably try to generate a double precision 64-bit instruction, okay, if the machine supports. Otherwise, that value will be broken down into two single precision 32-bit numbers, and the corresponding instructions will interpret these two together, actually. Okay. So we'll again look at, when you look at MIPS, 32-bit MIPS. We'll see how it actually manages 64-bit data types. For business transaction, accuracy of decimal arithmetic may be important. In fact, it is very important. So usually there you'd use packed decimal or binary coded decimal. So these are supported by x86. So you can actually generate BCD operand types in your x86 instructions. So what is binary coded decimal? Does anybody know? What is BCD? It's just a number system, just like your binary hexadecimal. What is BCD?
For each digit, we explicitly write its
decimal. Decimal, exactly, right. For each digit, so for example, if I write a number 23, its BCD encoding would be 0010, 0011. You need 4 bits, right? 0 to 9. Okay. So that's the BCD encoding of 23. Okay, all right. So why would you do that? Here is an example. Suppose you want to express the decimal number 0.1 in binary. Okay, how do you do that? How do you do that? 0.1 to binary. What's the procedure? Yeah, multiply by 2 and so what is it going to generate? 0.1, then 0.2, then 0.4, then 0.8, 1.6, then 1.2. So you're back here, right? So it recurs now, this part, right? So it's going to be a recurring binary representation. It's not going to terminate. So clearly, but you have to terminate it somewhere because your machine has only finite precision. It can only store a finite number of bits. The problem is that suppose you make a transaction of 20 rupees 10 paise. You convert it to binary inside your machine. You keep losing money slowly. Over time, it will build up by a huge amount actually. Okay. So that is the problem why the business transaction machines, like the ones that are used in banks and ATMs, would probably never use binary representation. Would routinely use purely BCD or would go to this packed decimal presentation. Is it clear to everybody? The problem of using binary? Okay. Your transactions will be inaccurate. Okay. And you'll start losing money or maybe gaining money, actually, okay, depending on which way you round off. and of course, I showed you how to represent an integer. So of course you can represent a fraction also in BCD. Okay, you'll have to put the fixed point somewhere, right? And you have an encoding for that. Fixed point GPUs and digital signal. So GPUs, they stand for graphics processing units, and digital signal processors are also very common. So here essentially what you do is you have a separate mantissa and exponent in your representation. So what are my operations? The final question, right? Simplest operations are used most frequently. For example, 10 x86 instructions were found to be sufficient to cover 96% of the entire spec integer 92 suit. It's an old suit, but this statistics hasn't changed much. Commonly supported operations are arithmetic and logic, load store operations, control transfer like the branch operations, system calls for talking to the operating system, to talk to your devices like the keyboards, displays, and all these things, and of course the floating point operations, okay, floating point arithmetic operations mostly. Optionally supported decimal arithmetic, supported by x86, string operations again supported by x86. By graphics here, I actually okay, so it's there. Okay, so graphics operations are often offloaded to a coprocessor. For example, your graphics processor should support special graphics instructions. Media and signal processors normally operate on narrow width data. So here also, by media, I mean multimedia extensions and all these, you know, instructions also come into the same category. So possible to execute multiple such operations in parallel. So these are often called as single instruction multiple data operations, SIMD. For example, your 4-wide SIMD in 32-bit Intel processors would have would actually have 128-bit wide registers, okay, so that it can operate on 32-bit operands together in parallel. Okay. Digital signal processors normally support saturating arithmetic, so by saturating arithmetic I mean that suppose you have a 4-bit register, okay, and the current value is let's say 14, you add 2 to it, so it will saturate at 15, it will not actually overflow and make a mess. Okay. The reason is that on overflow taking an exception is out of question, especially in real time applications. In real time applications you just cannot even think about an exception, because you would miss all the deadlines and that would be a big problem. So saturate to the maximum value. The DSPs also use something called multiply accumulate operations. So these are essentially fused multiply add. Okay. And very important when you are, for example, calculating inner product of two vectors. So essentially what you are doing is that you are just doing this, right? Xi, yi. Okay. So what it would do is it would multiply and add together. Okay, so it will fuse the whole thing into one instruction. Okay. So so let's show you how it actually operates. So initially you do x naught times y naught, right? Put it into some register Z. All right. Okay. Then after that, every instruction will be doing this. So this is just one instruction, multiply, accumulate together. Okay, it won't be two instructions. So that's the MAC. All right. So essentially you can complete doing an inner product of an two n dimensional vectors using essentially n instructions. Okay. You won't require 2n operations to do. Okay. So max per second is probably the most important metric used by digital signal processors. Okay.
These instructions also take same time as of multiplication.
It would take less time compared to doing a multiply and add. Yeah. May not be same, probably bigger than each of these,
but taken together
to be smaller. Okay, so let's take a look at so we'll spend some time talking about arithmetic logic, although I'm sure there isn't much to talk about. You know about this. These are add, subtract, multiply, divide, AND, OR, NOR, XOR, all these operations are arithmetic logic. Load, store, not much to talk about. Load from memory to a register, store from a register to memory, right? So let's talk a little bit about control transfer. So there are four major types of instructions. Conditional branches, most frequent, about 20% of all instructions. So which basically means that more or less every fifth instruction is a branch. Okay. So they're fairly frequent. Unconditional jumps could be direct or indirect. So direct unconditional jumps will actually encode your jump target address in the instruction, so that from the instruction you know where to go. Okay. Whereas unconditional indirect jumps would actually take your target from a register. Okay. So you have to read a register to know where to go. All right. Procedure calls, these are also unconditional jumps because there is no condition on that. You call a procedure, you go there. Okay. All right. Only difference with this is that you'll have to do some extra work to make sure that you come back to the right point when you return. All right. So that's procedure return. This is also another unconditional jump, but it does again some extra work. Make sure that you restart your execution from the point where you call the procedure. Okay. So naturally the question arises in all these cases is how to specify the target, because that's the most important thing when you talk about a branch instruction. Otherwise there is nothing very interesting, because your opcode will tell you that, oh, this is a branch instruction. Okay, right? Of course conditional branches would have another extra thing, that is the condition. Okay. So let's first see how to specify the target. If the compiler, okay, by the way, procedure calls may be of two types. Okay, maybe I'll talk about this when you talk about the targets. Okay, so let's hold on to that for some time. See, the compiler can figure out the target address, it includes it in the instruction, okay, as simple as that. Most frequent one is the PC relative targets. So these are essentially position independent because it reduces linker burden. Okay, because what it says is that, well, if you are now here, I would like to jump 16 more instructions down. Okay, that's a PC relative target. So finally, it doesn't matter where this code ultimately goes in what address, because this offset still remains unchanged. Okay. So then you don't have to think, the compiler doesn't have to worry about, oh, finally, where should this code sit if it has to generate these absolute addresses. Okay, which is why you will often find that compiler would generate this kind of addresses, PC related, because it's the easiest one to do. It decouples the compiler from the linker. Because the linker will finally decide where the code sits. Okay. Otherwise, any addressing mode can be used. For example, for PC relative addressing, we'd see that we'll actually use the immediate addressing mode, because we'll put the offset as an immediate value in the instruction. Okay, all right. So internally, what will happen is that the machine will take the immediate value, add it to the PC to generate the target. Okay. And of course, the immediate can be positive or negative. You can go backward, you can go forward. Either way, you can go. For procedure call and direct jumps, the target is normally included in the instruction as a large constant. Okay, all right. However, there is an exception. Procedure calls can be indirect, meaning that the compiler actually may not know the target when compiling the program. Can you think of any scenario?
Pointers?
Pointers?
Sorry, say again? The pointer functions.
Function pointers.
Yeah.
Yeah, function pointers, exactly. Anything else? Any other situations? Multiple?
The function is declaring another file which is linked while running compilation.
Dynamically linked.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let's talk about static binaries. Okay, we have static binaries only. Any other situations other than function pointers? Indirect procedure calls. So another example is virtual methods. Should actually internally your virtual methods get compiled into function pointers. The another example is switch case statements. Can you think about how a switch case statement would get compiled? How will it get compiled? You have a switch, you have a bunch of cases.
Conditional.
Would it be conditional jumps? What is a clean way of compiling switch case? So there is a restriction on your case argument. It has to be an integer. Do you know why? Right? Does everybody know that case arguments have to be integers? Right? It cannot be a floating point number, for example. Why is that?
Because floating point numbers loses the value.
Loses the value.
Loses or means you cannot store it exact precision.
That's fine. That's an implementation detail. What would be a clean way to compile switch case? Would it be a series of conditional branches or? Okay, I'll tell you what it normally does. Those who are taking a compiler course this semester will probably learn. So essentially, the compiler builds a table. Okay. So each case target will be the table entry. All right. So case 0 will have the case 0 target will be in the first row of the table. Case 1 will have the second row of the table, and so on. Okay. And when you do the switch at runtime, it will resolve what the switch value is, and it will actually call the procedure at that particular row of the table. So essentially, it's an indirect. Well, it's not exactly a procedure call, it's actually indirect unconditional jump. You can think of it in that way. Okay. It goes there, at runtime it resolves the value and calls the corresponding, essentially changes the PC to point to the content of that row of the table. Okay. Anyway, so for indirect procedure calls, of course you cannot put the target in the instruction because you don't know. what you would usually do is you will have an instruction first to load the target into a register, and that register will be used in your procedural call. Okay, so at runtime the value will be picked up from the register and will take the will make the charge.
Cases values may not be sequential.
Right, yes, exactly.
So how does it know which slot, which entry it belongs to?
Sequential in the sense?
In the sense, if there are numbers 0 and 2, then it knows that 0 is the first,
okay,
second, third. Mm-hmm. But if some random number, then how mm-hmm. does it know that which number sits in which location? I mean, suppose
it's 0, 30, okay. 7. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So it will actually have a mapping for that also. Yes. Yes. Of course. The actual value mapping to the number of row. Yeah. Okay. So indirect jumps and procedure return. Again, procedure return. That's also not known at compile time. Why is that? Where I should return. I have a procedure which I'm trying to compile, and at the end I have a return statement. Do I know where to return? Mm-hmm. Why not?
We don't know from where it has been called.
Exactly. So there will be multiple places from where I can call this procedure. Right? So depending on your execution, it might have to return to several other places. Okay. So not known at compile time. So you can use any addressing mode other than absolute, because absolute is used only when you know at compile time. Okay, right? the simplest one is register addressing, that is place the target in a register. That's what is used. You place a target in a register and use that register in your instruction for jumping. Indirect jumps appear when using, so there you go, switch case blocks, virtual methods, function pointers, dynamically shared libraries, somebody has pointed out. Normally the target is loaded from memory into a register at runtime. Okay. How big is the precipitative offset? 10 bits seems sufficient in most cases. So again, the question is, I am here now, I have a precipitative branch instruction. What is the range? How far can I go? Positive or negative, right? Turns out that 1024 is in most cases enough. So 1024 this direction or that direction. Okay, 10 bit offset. So the next component of the conditional branches is the condition, right? How to specify branch conditions? So there are several ways of doing that. One possibility is to use condition code, that is test special bits set by the ALU operation. So this is exactly what is used by x86. So you would first do the ALU operation, like suppose you want to check for greater than equal to. Okay. So you would first do the comparison, and depending on the comparison outcome, the ALU would set some flag somewhere. Okay. And then you will have a branch instruction which would, depending on the status of that flag, will either branch to some location or just continue. Okay, all right. So it creates an implicit dependence for the branch and that makes your instruction reordering hard. So simple reason is that your branch instruction now would depend on the ALU instruction. Unless the ALU instruction completes, the branch cannot go. And the more problematic thing is that this particular flag that this ALU instruction sets usually doesn't appear as part of the instruction. It's an implicit target that, oh, you should actually implicitly change that flag. Okay. That is the most problematic part, because if a compiler is looking at these instructions and trying to reorder them, it can easily make a mistake, thinking that, oh, this instruction, these two instructions look actually independent. But actually implicitly the ALU instruction would change a flag which the branch instruction depends on. Okay. So all these things will have to be kept in mind when writing the compiler. So found in x86. ARM, PowerPC, Spark. Okay. The other option is to use the general purpose registers instead of special flags. The comparison result is put into the one of the general purpose registers, and the branch will actually check that register before branching. Okay. So here it's explicit in the instruction. The ALU operation would actually have this particular register as its destination, and the branch will have this register as a source. Okay, so there is a very clear dependence between these two instructions. So there is an explicit dependence found in MIPS and ALPA. Okay. And the third option is compare and branch. That is, you fuse these two things together in a single instruction. Some flavors of comparison are fused with branch instruction. So one instruction per branch instead of two. So you save an instruction. You don't have to split it into two instructions, you can do it in one. But of course, what flavors of comparisons you can fuse with the branch will depend on the complexity of the comparison operation. Because we have to remember that I am now putting it in a single instruction, it better be simple. So complicated comparisons may affect your CPI, and this is found in VAX. This is the Hewlett-Packard's processor, PA-RISC, MIPS alpha. So notice that MIPS has both of these flavors, and actually we'll see both of these when you talk about the MIPS ISA. Turns out that a large number of comparisons are actually against zero. So this is probably the most frequent comparison that you'd like to know whether it is less than zero, greater than zero, rather than equal to 0 and so on. And also less than and less than equal to are very frequent because of the loop control. The loop control is usually less than or less than equal to. You say your loop, tell me if I is less than or less than equal to my upper bound of the loop. Okay, so procedure calls. So what must happen on a call? So some of you probably already know what has to happen. So the most important thing that has to happen is you need to save the return address somewhere so that you can come back to the right place. Okay. Normally it is a dedicated link register or some arbitrary general purpose register. Okay. So this particular term is used in the MIPS world, the link register. So I want to introduce you to this and we'll actually use this also later in the course. But anyway, the point is that there is usually a dedicated register, or you could pick up one of the general purpose registers and put your return address there. Okay. Also, you may need to set up the parameters that are going to be passed to the procedure. Some architectures implicitly do this as part of the call, while most generate explicit code for this. Okay. So some of the architectures, for example, MIPS would actually generate explicit code for passing the parameter, and exactly how you pass the parameter will depend on the architecture. We'll talk about that later. Okay. So you may want to pass the parameter through some register. You may want to pass the parameter through memory. So we can do many other ways. The caller, meaning that from wherever you are calling the procedure, may want to save some registers so that the callee cannot destroy them. By callee, I mean the procedure itself. Okay, all right. So for example, I might be doing some computation, and now I need to call a procedure. But I'll require this computation after the procedure. So I want to save the registers where I have the results of this computation. Okay, right? So this is known as caller saving convention. All right? So the caller, before calling the procedure, would save whatever is important. Okay, all right? Symmetrically, you can think of a situation where the callee may save any register that it wants to use in later point of the procedure. So what may happen is that caller says that, well, I don't care. So let the callee do whatever it needs to modify. Okay. So the callee, before starting, it figures out, oh, these are the registers I'll probably require to modify, so let me save them first. Okay. So that I can restore them at the end of the procedure. So this is known as callee saving convention. Alright. So both of these are fine. You can use mix of them. So caller may save certain registers, callee may save certain registers, and so on. And of course, it may be hard for the compiler to decide what to use, because often you learn in your compiler course that inter-procedural analysis is hard. So when you are calling a function, it may be very difficult to figure out what are the registers that the procedure you are calling will actually modify. Okay. So that may not be very easy to figure out. So most architectures offer both today, with clearly specified caller saved and callee saved register sets. So what happens ultimately is that to make the compiler's job easier, architectures actually specify, so I'm talking very much in terms of MIPS here. X86 actually doesn't have any of these notions. In MIPS architecture, what they say is that I have these four registers which are caller saved. Okay. Meaning that before you call a function, the caller has to save these four registers. In other words, the callee is free to modify these registers without even worrying about anything. Okay. That's what it really means. Okay. Similarly, it would also have a set of three or four registers which are callee saved registers, meaning that the callee, before starting the procedure, will actually save these registers. Okay. So caller need not worry about these registers. Okay. All right. And which, in other words, which it says is that the callee saved register contents will be restored at the end of the procedure. so that the caller can, if it wants to save something, it can use these registers. Right?
So this GPR is combining both of them, poly, caller plus something.
Yes, yes, yes. This is the most flexible one. This is giving compiler full freedom of picking whatever register it wants to pick. Yeah, exactly. Okay, so combining all these ideas, essentially what you finally want is an instruction encoding. Okay, that you have defined certain instructions, you have already defined, you know, what instructions would have what operands and how much of displacement you would require, what addressing modes you would require, and finally what you want is the encoding of the instruction, that how many bits I should have in the instruction, what fields my instruction should have, and so on and so forth. So it has implication on code size, memory requirement, and power. All instructions have an opcode field to specify the operation, so this is mandatory.
Okay.
So when you have an instruction, you should have an opcode field which says what this instruction is. Is it an add operation? Is it a branch operation? Is it a load operation? What is it actually?
Okay.
Important decision is how many bits for addressing modes, because this one is easy. You figure out how many instructions, how many operations you want to support, log of that would be this.
Okay.
This many bits you would require for the opcode, as simple as that. How many bits for addressing modes? Also, number of registers, number of addressing modes, and total number of operands in an instruction have significant impact on code size, because number of registers would determine how many bits you will require to address a register, because log of that would be the number of bits you would require to address a register. Number of addressing modes would essentially decide how many bits you would require for your displacement or any other encoding of the addressing mode. Or even in the worst case, you may have to do the following, that you have so many addressing modes that you will have to reserve special bits to specify what addressing mode is this.
Okay.
Like if you have, you know, 32 addressing modes, you would have to actually reserve 5 bits in your instruction to say, oh, this is using that jumbo mumbo addressing mode actually. Okay, right. So those 5 bits will have to be there. And total number of operands will of course will have to go in the instructions. Like for example, if you decide that, oh, my instructions are going to be very long, it is going to have 6 operands. Okay, even if you have 32 registers and all the operands are register operands, you are going to require 30 bits to specify these operands, because 5 bits each, you have 6 operands. Okay, right? So there is a limit on this, that you know how many operands you can really, really encode. Of course, it's always good to have large number of operands, because that means you can execute complicated instructions in a single instruction. Okay. So overall, you have to weigh all these things with the CPI.
Okay.
And as I told you, the usual method is that you would finally filter out 2, 3, 4 candidate instruction sets. You would probably have compiler for all these 4. You'd compile your benchmarks into all these 4s, and you'd actually simulate all these 4 possible binaries, see the final performance, and decide which one finally goes.
Okay.
Too many operands and addressing modes may necessitate separate address specifier field for each operand. For example, what mode is used for this operand? Oh yeah, so this is another thing. You can have actually cross products now. You have 6 operands, you have 32 addressing modes. You can say, oh, operand 1 uses addressing mode 30. Operand 2 uses addressing mode 25. Okay, so you can actually think of this cross product now. So now that, you know, very quickly explodes your instruction size. So x86 has all these things actually, which is why x86 actually has variable length of instructions. Instruction length is actually not fixed. Okay. With few addressing modes that can be encoded in the opcode itself, usually this is what you really want.
Okay.
So you can have, we can say that, well, I'll have 2 addressing modes, and I can have, if I have, you know, 4 load operations, I'll just have double the numbers. I'll have 8 load operations, and I'll actually have opcodes for separate addressing modes.
Okay,
that's easy, in fact. So one more thing that you have to decide at this point is whether you are going to have a fixed instruction length for all instructions, or you're going to vary the instruction size,
okay,
for different instructions. So fixed length instructions have a fixed number of operands, like your classical 3 operand instructions, and a few addressing modes, 2 or 3, that can be encoded in the opcode. So essentially the point is that all my instructions are going to have a constant length. That helps the instruction fetcher a lot, because it knows that If I fetch 100 bytes, I can calculate how many instructions I have fetched because I know the length of each instruction. Also, fixed length instructions sacrifice in terms of code size to gain in terms of complexity and performance, because essentially what you are doing is that you might be wasting bits to make your all instructions of equal size. Right? Because what may happen is that some instructions you could actually encode in with smaller bits, but you would actually increase them to this boundary to make sure that all your instructions are of equal length. Okay. But of course, you gain in terms of complexity and performance because now they are easier to decode, because you know that, oh, I have fetched 4 bytes, which means I have one instruction now, I can start decoding. On the other hand, if you have variable length instructions, you have to keep on fetching until you have the full instruction, and that's very difficult to know when you have a full instruction. So variable length instructions, for example, you have x86 having 1 to 17 bytes of instructions. So you can have all possibilities actually. Require complicated decoders, offers a lot of addressing modes, and produces very compact code. So that's the advantage with fixed length encoding. So x86 essentially say that, well, if I can encode an instruction in a byte, I'm going to do that. I'm not going to increase it to match some constant length for everybody. And also possible to do a hybrid encoding, like your ARM, Thumb, and MIPS. 16 offers 16 and 32-bit encoding. 16-bit encoding is used for instructions with small immediates, a subset of registers, and 2 operand format. Whereas if you want to support, you know, more operands, bigger register number, you'd switch to a 32-bit one.